Thanks for having made it to the Primer on Severe Brain Injury at TBILAW. I'm Gordon Johnson, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about what our goals are on this Primer on Severe Brain Injury. We're first going to cover some basic definitional things about the diagnosis that your loved one has probably been given by the neurosurgeon. There are two really critical things for you to understand when dealing with the questions of brain bleeds and hemorrhage. The first is that blood is a toxic element to brain tissue if it's not inside of blood vessels, if it's not where it's supposed to be. And the second is, anytime you have a brain bleed or even a significant hematoma or swelling, what happens is that the brain becomes compressed by the additional amount of fluid that is contained. We have a model, and this is something we use in the courtroom from time to time, and I have several different kinds, and I also have a foam rubber model of the brain. But to start with, in terms of understanding the issues with brain bleeds and hemorrhage and with brain swelling, is we should probably take the top off of our model skull, and this one is plastic. If we were talking more about specific other issues, I'd probably use an actual human skull to show you, but this is a plastic skull, and we can quite easily take the top off. You can see inside here is an actual representation of a human brain, and what's different about this brain that I contain here and the one I have in my hand is that this is a very firm, hard object. You don't see any shimmer. And in this brain, you do see the shimmer, and that will be more important when we talk about rotational injury and axonal injuries. But this brain is actually much closer to the consistency of an actual human brain. But the key thing to understand when you're talking about bleeds, brain pressure events, is that this skull has a certain amount of volume. It's like a football or a basketball. It can only take so much air. Now, or perhaps even a car tire can only take so much air. Ultimately, if you put too much air in it, it'll blow up. If you put too much blood inside of the skull, if there's a bleed in the brain and the heart keeps pumping more and more fluid into the brain, but because it's not in a blood vessel, there's no way to get it out, it gets to be more and more pressure. And ultimately, that pressure is what causes the most serious damage in most severe brain injuries. As the more and more fluids, more and more blood accumulates in it, what happens is the smallest blood vessels, the capillaries, get compressed. So there may be enough power in the heart to push blood through the major blood vessels, but the smaller the blood vessels are, the more that pressure, that compression of the brain mass, because there's only so much room inside the skull, the compression of that brain mass cuts off the blood flow to those smallest vessels. And when blood flow doesn't get to those small blood vessels, major areas of the brain will begin to die. And the reason it dies is that it doesn't get fresh oxygen, it doesn't get fresh glucose, which is the brain's fuel, and more significantly, the toxic waste products that's created with this chemical reaction, little tiny fire that runs the brain, those fumes, those toxic byproducts of the chemical reaction don't get removed, and then the brain becomes a very toxic environment, and it ultimately dies.